We need to ensure, first of all, that all of us individually and collectively are at peace with God and each other. We need to maintain our optimum position of thankfulness because there is a God and we're not Him. We need to proclaim the grace of Christ. It needs to be at the core of who we are, and it needs to be what motivates us and what pushes us forward, whether we're meeting in a board meeting or gathering for social time or worshiping together or doing something through the week. We are here to proclaim the message of Christ. That's who we are. And we need to rest from our own power and walk in the power of Jesus Christ.
Want to watch for the P's in this message. There will be four of them.
And he says there, first of all, in verse 15, that we are to let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts. Now remember, Jesus said, "My peace I give to you." Peace is a fleeting thing, isn't it? In most cases. Isn't that what we as a culture, as a world, have been craving for generation after generation after generation? Wouldn't we all, how many times have we heard it said, peace in our time? And while we crave it and we desire it, we're unable to bring it to pass. Peace is hard to sustain. And yet, Jesus said, "My peace I give you." See, this is a different thing entirely. Then it becomes a matter of not us maintaining the peace, but Him. We receive the peace of Christ when we accept Him as Savior. The moment you receive Jesus as your Savior, He infused all parts of you, all aspects of you, with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit came and took up residence in you and your life. And that happened at the moment of conversion. Now, because of that, you receive the peace of Christ. It is, as the scripture says, the peace that passes understanding. And it's deep down. There are children's songs about that. I have the peace that passes understanding. Where? Down in my heart. Some of you grew up in Sunday school like I did. And you know that's an understanding that we want to give our children, and we as adults need to maintain it. The peace of Christ, once grounded and embedded in our hearts, not the blood pumping muscle in your chest, but your essence down deep, the core of who you are. Once the peace of Christ goes there, nothing can mess with it. It is there. It becomes transcendent in all of life's situations. And the peace of Christ applies not only to our relationship with God, which of course is our primary relationship, but our relationship with each other. How is it that the church works? Now granted, sometimes it just doesn't. But most of the time, no matter where you go, when you find a group of people who follow Christ and study His Word and worship together and work alongside one another, the relationships that they have with one another are not only strong, they endure. How is that possible? Because of the peace of Christ. We have differences, you and I. And all of you have differences with one another. And if we sat here long enough and tried hard enough, we could find something that we could really have a good argument over. If we chose to. But see, the peace of Christ is within us. And He says, as members of how many bodies? One body, it says in the text. As members of one body, we are to let the peace of Christ rule. Now, remember when Jesus sat down with His apostles? And He knew His time was short. And He knew He wanted to establish His church. And it was going to need to last throughout generations, all the way up to us. And all the way beyond us, if He tarries that long, to the day that He chooses to come. Now, He said, love one another. Pretty simple. Love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one. See, that complicates things for me, Lord. Love one another. Okay, that's easy. We get that. That's warm and fuzzy. We like that. We have affection for our families and our friends and the people we like, but that's not what He said. As I have loved you, love one another. Now it's beyond me, isn't it? It's beyond you. Because there are people, quite frankly, I don't like. You're all laughing because you agree with me. But because of the peace of Christ within our hearts, not in our own strength, the love of Christ, the peace of Christ within us transcends all of this stuff. And when the peace of Christ rules in our individual hearts, here's the beauty of it. When the peace of Christ rules in our individual hearts, we as a congregation move forward at peace with God and one another. This is a vintage church at its best. Secondly, there is the position. Keeping notes. He says at the second part of verse 15, be thankful. I have had people teaching me to be thankful since I believe day one. What do parents teach their children? In fact, earlier today, I was handing out candy here and there. And, oh, I missed one. I missed you. Now, whenever I do that, inevitably one of you parents will say, what do you say? Just like was done to you when you were a child and was probably done to your parents when they were children. Expressing gratitude matters, doesn't it? It shows respect. It shows an appreciation. It shows love. Thankful in the New Testament comes from the Greek word eucharistos, which sounds like Eucharist, doesn't it? That's where the word comes from. It is a description of communion or the Lord's Supper. That's the root of this word, eucharistos. The word comes from the Greek root, ultimately, charis, which means grace, kindness, favor. In other words, you and I are thankful because of God's grace and His kindness and His favor. And we recognize our position. Being thankful is the optimum position in life when you think about it. You wake up in the morning, it's doing the stuff it's doing outside right now, and you find things to be thankful for. Makes the whole day better, doesn't it? See, this isn't positive thinking. This isn't the self-help things that we talked about last week. This is thankful to God. Wake up in the morning, it's nasty outside, I may not feel real good or whatever, but I check my pulse. My grandfather taught me this. Check my pulse, and if I feel something, I've got a reason to be thankful. If I don't, I should let somebody know. The idea is, it puts us in a position that we need to be in. It reminds us of who we are and who we were. In Colossians 1:21, Paul writes, once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. But now He has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you in His sight without blemish and free from accusation. See? Thankfulness puts us in a position where we recognize, you know, once I didn't have any of this. Once I had no relationship with Christ. Once I was separated from God. Once I was going to die here physically and then die there spiritually forever and ever, over and over again, forever. And now I'm not. That's thankful. Thankful reminds us of those things. Thankful also keeps our ego in check. When we are thankful, we are reminded there is a God and I am not Him. And He doesn't ask me what He's going to do. He doesn't always inform me of His plans. He's God. I'm not. He doesn't have to tell me everything. David put it this way in Psalm chapter 8. When I consider your heavens and the work of your fingers and the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is humanity that you are mindful of them? What are human beings that you even care for them? You see, thankfulness motivates love and obedience to Christ because it brings me back into check where I recognize that not only is God God, but His way of living is in fact the best way. And that pushes legalism aside, that pushes all those other things that people come up with aside, and it focuses us on Christ. And we obey Him because we love Him and because His way of life is blessed. As we recognize our position in thankfulness individually and as a congregation, we move forward as a vintage church. And then there's proclamation. He says in verse 16 that we are to let the message of Christ dwell in us richly. And he lists ways that that takes place. This thing, the message of Christ, you get that. The message of Christ, is, it says in Acts 10, is the good news of peace through Jesus Christ. And in Ephesians 1:13 it says, it is the message of the gospel of salvation. That's the message of Christ. And we are to take this message of Christ and let it dwell in us richly. Now, how do we do that? We have to let it in. The message of Christ cannot dwell in someone who has not yet received Him as Savior. That's where the process begins. And once we have received Him as Savior, then the message of Christ can dwell in us. You remember our function from a few weeks ago? We talked about the function, the ultimate purpose of the church. Jesus told us to go and make disciples of all nations. Now, oftentimes we make the mistake of one of two things. We either assume that that's the preacher's job to do on our behalf, or we assume that that is a task reserved only for the church gathered. That's not what Jesus said at all. Those two things apply. Yeah, as a minister, I should be out spreading the gospel, not because I'm a minister, but because I'm a follower of Christ. And as a church, of course, that's our function. That's what we are about. Let's make sure the gospel gets spread and that people have the opportunity to receive Christ. But what about when we're scattered? What about when we're not together all in one place and it's comfortable and it's safe and it's not snowing in here? Even individually, we are responsible to proclaim the gospel. In fact, Isaiah prophesied. Now, he was talking about Jesus, but it applies to us. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness, to proclaim the season of the Lord's favor. We're in that right now, the season of His favor. Eventually, the time will come when the Holy Spirit is no longer present in this place. And when that happens, there will be no opportunity for men and women and boys and girls to come to Christ. They won't be able to sense His presence. Proclamation of the message of Christ is our function, not only as a church, but as individuals. That's why Paul wrote in Romans 10, "The word is near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart. The message concerning the faith that we proclaim." We proclaim the message of Christ, as he says, as we teach one another and admonish one another. We're doing that now. Teaching, admonishing, using the scripture to benefit one another, to grow in Christ. We proclaim the message of Christ in that. We proclaim the message of Christ, as the text says, through psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit. You know, we've already done all three of those. And I think we had fun with all of them. When we gathered together and service started, Jim read a psalm for us. You may notice we always try to find a way to work a passage from Psalms into the worship celebration. Why? Because it says so. It belongs in worship. The book of Psalms is, in fact, a worship book. That's what it was gathered together to be. So we proclaim the message of Christ through the psalms that we read, through the hymns that we sing, and through songs from the Spirit when we do the praise songs and that kind of thing. So, wow, all of a sudden there's room for all of that in worship. All of it is good. All of it is a proclamation of the message of Christ. And we proclaim the message of Christ in our actions and our attitudes, as well as our words, when we're away from it. Through proclamation of the message of Christ, the gospel, we move forward as a vintage church. And then finally, there's the power. There has to be something to make all of this go. I was pushing the snowblower around the sidewalks earlier this week, kind of going along and trying to clear some out and help out. Remember, I told you last Sunday, when you see something I'm doing, do it. So that's what we've been doing this week. And I got all the way around here as far as I could possibly be from the garage, and the thing quit on me. Now, it's a good snowboard. It's in good repair. It works well. It runs great. It's self-propelled. It's actually kind of fun to run. But it quit on me. It's out of gas. And they'll quit every time when you run the gas out of them. Well, I had neglected, and it was my own fault, because I had used the gas that was in the can, and the can is empty. And now I've got a snowblower sitting out in front, and I've got an empty gas can, and I can't leave the snowblower out front. I mean, I know it's Durand, but you might as well put a sign out that says, "Free snowblower, help yourself." So without it being able to be started, I have to drag the snowblower back to the garage, put it away, all the while telling myself how stupid I was not to get gas before I started. And then I go down to Ed's, I get the gas, I start to snowboard, and it, boom, it's right back to life again. Things are great. Power. What makes it go? And our power, in verse 17, Paul says this, whatever you do, now whatever you do, just as a little side note, is not just church stuff. That's not what he said. Whatever you do, that pretty much covers all of life, doesn't it? Okay, whatever you do, whether in word or in deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. Whatever you do, everything. This is a big statement, and it applies to me individually. It applies to my family. It applies to our church together. Whatever you do, do it all in the name of Christ. Why? Because the name of the Lord Jesus is our source of power. If we begin to operate outside of His name, because His name gives us identity, tells who we are. His name gives us access to God. That's how we enter in. That's why we pray in the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus opens things up and empowers us for the tasks that He gives us individually and as a congregation. Remember, He said in Matthew 28, just before the Great Commission, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. In other words, as God incarnate, Jesus Christ is omnipotent. That's an impressive sounding word, isn't it? It's a 50-cent theological word that just means all-powerful. Not just most powerful, not just strongest kid on the block, all power, all authority, all power belongs to Christ. That's why He could say of His church, and this includes us, the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Why? Because of the name of Jesus. Not because we're congregational, although I think congregational is a pretty good way to be. But because of the name of Jesus in each of us individually and in all of us as His church gathered. And we must never forget that the name of Jesus is our source of power. It is the power to overcome sin, Scripture teaches. It is the power to live according to His teachings. It is the power to be His church. The power to maintain relationships with one another, even when we drive one another. It is the power to carry out the Great Commission function that Jesus gave us. That's why Paul wrote, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes. And the Spirit of God does not make us timid, but gives us power. We don't operate in our own power. We operate in His power. And through the power of the name of the Lord Jesus, we have a vintage church for His glory and for His purpose. Going forward, let us consider this path. Everybody wants to build a plan. And they, if you're a pastor, you read a lot of stuff about the future of the church and building your church and growing your church. And I have to be honest with you, I've stopped reading those. Not because I know everything, because I certainly don't. You can put my knowledge of the dump truck load of things that I need to know in a thimble. I've only got about that much covered. But the idea is, right here in this passage, we see how to move forward. We don't necessarily have to change the way we worship. We don't have to go out and build a new building or relocate or change our structure or do all those other things that some are trying to do. Those things don't bring growth. Oftentimes they just bring conflict because they mess with our foundations. Here's what we need. We need to ensure, first of all, that all of us individually and collectively are at peace with God and each other. We need to maintain our optimum position of thankfulness because there is a God and we're not Him. We need to proclaim the name of Christ. It needs to be at the core of who we are and it needs to be what motivates us. and what pushes us forward, whether we're meeting in a board meeting or gathering for social time or worshiping together or doing something through the week. We are here to proclaim the message of Christ. That's who we are. And we need to rest from our own power and walk in the power of Jesus Christ. Because it's in Him that the good stuff happens. It's in Him that men and women, boys and girls come to Christ. It's in Him that this church that has done so for over 100 years will continue to move forward for His glory and be a light here in this community.
Fun storming the castle.
Think it'll work?
It would take a miracle.
Bye-bye. Bye.